Thank you all of you and welcome to the conference call. This is Bhaskar Bhatt. We have just uploaded the presentation. As you can see, we have closed the year quite significantly well with the quarter four revenues grew 19% and PBT, of course, before exceptional items by 7%. There are a couple of things that we want to share with you. PBT was impacted by an additional provision for investments in ILNFS. Temporary inventory valuation hit in jewelry of the order of magnitude of 37 crores. And ex-gratia for employees on account of the exceptional performance of 34 crores. We have provided entirely for the LFS, which is 155 crores total. We had, if you remember, provided up to the Q3 of 99 crores, and now we provided 46 crores more. The company also invested 100 crores in its subsidiary, CaratLane, therefore increasing stake from 66.39 to 69.47%. There is one more. Based on the current performance of Papa Luba, the brand which we acquired several years ago, the brand is yet to acquire stature in the markets where it's selling. It has now got a new strategy with a much greater India focus, but we still felt it was prudent to impair, after last year's impairment of 75 crores, a further 70 crores in FY19. We believe we have something good going for the future in this brand, looking at the India opportunity, the significant change in India as we see in the future. So the impairment was prudent. The directors, of course, have announced a dividend of 5 rupees per equity share. It represents a 33% increase on a per share basis over last year. I think the rest is in front of you as far as Q4 is concerned. One of the highlights of the year, just on a subsidiary, we will talk about, of course, the company in the Q&A. But the subsidiary Teal, Titan Engineering and Automation Limited, has performed extraordinarily well, with revenues growing 42%, but it has posted an extraordinary profit of 58 crores on a turnover of about 348 crores. I think I'll hand over to you for the Q&A. I have my colleagues, Ronnie, Venkat, Ravi, Subbu, Raj, and Ajoy, and Sandeep, I assume.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone phone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Abneesh Roy from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. My first question is on the margins in watch and eyewear. Watch margins have been volatile and it's down quarter on quarter and YOY both in this quarter. So if you could comment the intensity, is it more because of ad spends punching up this quarter? And similarly, eyewear, most of the quarters last year has been challenging. When do you see decent margins in eyewear?
Ravi will talk about watches and Ronnie thereafter.
Hello, Pulkit. We are not getting audio from the line. Can you please check if it's self-muted?
Who is this?
Sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. I think we were on mute. Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Hi, Avnish. Am I being heard?
Yes, sir.
Are we here? Okay, Avnish, before I come to the specific reason for quarter four, the margin, as you mentioned, is certainly not showing any volatile patterns. It is as expected and as it's, it was supposed to happen. For the simple reason that, you know, quarter after quarter, we have been saying that don't look at the specific quarter, look at the full year. So the overall perspective that I wanted to share with you is that the fourth quarter is always the weakest quarter in terms of sales for the watches business. Coming to the EBIT margin, if you look at the EBIT margin of the last 5 years, in the fourth quarter, in 3 years, the margin, EBIT margin has been around 7%. In 1 year, it was 2.7%. And in 1 year, it was a loss. Okay. And this year is 5.5. So it is really, as I said, when the sales are low, which is the weakest amongst all the four quarters, plus a lot of provisions get made. So coming to specifically this year, in the fourth quarter, the product and the channel mix have thrown up this. So this is really an outcome, have thrown up this margin. Plus the, you know, the ex gratia payment to employees has also come in this quarter. There has also been, you know, we will talk about it. If you look at the full year, we'll talk about it a little later if required. This year has actually been the best year, Avinish, in terms of the highest ever EBIT margin, the highest ever profit, of course. A whole lot of milestones in terms of what the brands have achieved, plus a significant foray into the wearable segment. So in the fourth quarter, the mix got also affected by a large buyout of, you know, from the outside in terms of wearables and licensed brands, which also impact our margins. So basically product mix, channel mix, and the ex gratia. So don't look at this quarter, look at the full year, and it is the one of the best years in terms of, you know, sales growth being 14-15% for the year, but the profit growth is more than 20%.
So on this wearables, is that the fitness band you are referring to? I saw very high advertising on the fitness band. So isn't that a lower margin business anyway?
So Abhish, we have we have formed a separate vertical called PAD and wearables, which stands for personal adornment devices and wearables, which includes the bands that you are referring to as well as smartwatches. So we have launched a whole lot of smartwatches and bands and a couple of bands in the last year. But last quarter was the highest in terms of and that is how it affected the. So yes, being a completely bought out product to some extent, because it's imported, the margins would be lower than what we manufacture in house.
And my other question was on eyewear margins.
Yes, Avnish, this is Ronnie. I'll answer your question on eyewear margins. You said were challenging right through the year, every quarter. You're correct in that. They weren't really challenging. This was how we had planned it, actually. In this year, if you remember our business plan, we had said that we will go after customers, acquiring new customers, and over a 5-year period, we would have 10 million customers a year. In that journey, we have moved this year from 2.4 million customers to 3.5 million customers. We've grown our customer base by more than 45%. And that has mainly come on the back of disproportionate advertising. We've invested in advertising to build awareness of the Titan Eye Plus chain and Titan Eyewear as a brand. So this was a very conscious decision we took, and the results have been extremely good. Our top line has grown at over 23%, and overall business has been very good this year. The EBIT margin was a conscious decision to invest in advertising, like I said, and not worry about the margin at this stage, but focus more on customers.
Avnish, if I were to just close these two conversations in one way, you know, volume and acquiring more and more customers, volume has always been a very big focus in the watch business, and eyewear pursuing 10 million, number of customers that you touch, going after that, and therefore, in a way, investing in that is where this margin dilution you might see. And in watches, it is all the more important to go after the technology customers. And we are doing a combination of in-house manufacturing, but that will kick in only in the future. But a lot of it is buying out. So, but overall, the watch margin has been improving over the years, as you can see in the last 2-3 years.
Thank you. Participants are requested to limit their questions to two per participant. Time permitting, you may come back in the queue for a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Avi Mehta from India Infoline. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Hello, can you hear me?
Hello, yes.
Yeah. Sir, my first question is essentially on the, across the space, we are hearing consumer companies pointing to weakness in the rural market. And, you know, we've seen market share gains for more than a year now. What is it that kind of gives us confidence on, you know, achieving that 20% guidance in the jewelry business? Or do you see, you know, weakness in the underlying industry growth kind of reversing? Is that something that you're seeing? That was the first question. The second was on, you know, guidance on, you know, if you could share on the next year's watch margins, especially because you, it did highlight 14-15% for the year in the watch segment. How do we see it going forward? And similar guidance for the jewelry margins.
I only start by in one thing, which is the first part, which is to do with we are certainly playing out in the jewelry business, and Venkat will talk about it a little more. Our expansion is happening in those areas, and we are seeing significant opportunity in that. Rural, they are not really, really rural. They are urban and actually growing in these middle class, in these what we call as middle India. I think that, Venkat, you could talk more about the opportunity that we are seeing. And the 20% growth that we have targeted for the year, it is a very challenging target, but we do see our ability to achieve that. It is the manner in which our business model works in terms of brands and network and so on. Venkat?
Yeah. Avi, the opportunity in the jewelry market is so large that even if there is some contraction in the overall demand, we still have substantial space to expand within. And the consolidation that is happening in the industry because of structural reforms are certainly also enabling. And they're sitting on top of the strategies that we initiated 3 years back, and the execution of which is getting, you know, better and better. So that's the reason why we're continuing to grow. And on, I think, your question 2 and 3, perhaps we will reserve it for day after tomorrow, which is FY20 related questions.
Okay, so that will be in the analyst day, I'm assuming. So, if I may, can you give any guidance on the tax rate? That's all.
Because on the tax rate,
even that
next year should be generally in the same ballpark as it is this year. I would say between 29% roughly would be the ballpark.
Okay, sir. I'll come back in the queue for the other questions. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Aditya Suman from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
Hi, two questions from my end. Firstly, on Taneira, as a brand, do you think you have the strategy in place to roll it out in a faster manner, and do you think it will be a meaningful contributor to the growth of the company, say, 5 years out? And the second question is on the Favre Luba write-off. We do not see this on the console numbers. The write-off is only in the standalone numbers. Is that understanding right?
Okay, I'll just explain the Favre Luba before Joy takes on the Taneira question. The impairment is based on the investment that Titan Company on a standalone basis has made on Favre Luba. So the impairment is therefore only in the standalone accounts, whereas when we consolidate the losses of Favre Luba also. So the consolidated numbers therefore will reflect that as well. So therefore the profit difference is visible. We will not do an impairment again on the Favre Luba investment because it's already consolidated. Joy.
Hi. Oscar, did you want to share anything?
No. I think our strategy is getting developed. We are very clear about the way forward based on the 2 stores earlier and now 4 stores. And I think Ajay will be able to articulate it much better. Of course, as we move from city to city, opening store to store, we are gathering more and more knowledge. We just opened Hyderabad 2 days back, and we had 70 clusters under one roof, whereas when we opened the first, we had only 31. So we are learning, but the overall strategy of getting the Indian women with Indian silk and etc., that is very clear, and we do see a very significant opportunity in this. The size, etc., I think Ajay will share with you. Ajay, go ahead.
Yeah. So the strategy, both in terms of product strategy, sourcing and supply chain strategy and the retail strategy are clear. The last 2 years, where we've been running 4 stores, not for the entire year, but for most of the year, has thrown up enough learning for us and enough confidence that we are now on the anvil of scaling up. In the current year, we are looking at adding 14 new stores, and over the next 5 years, we expect to reach out to the top 20 cities with a significant number of stores. Maybe we, in terms of its total potential size, etc., maybe, you know, on Friday when there is some opportunity to share how big this business can be. But it is significantly large.
Understand. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amit Sachdeva from HSBC. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for taking my question. Just very quickly on, you know, jewelry sort of EBIT. I see Bhaskar make a comment about 37 crore sort of inventory devaluation, which would be reversed in the next quarter. It is probably the expected hedging gain will reverse it, and how this dynamic will work. And I also seen the base, there was 18 crore worth of hedging gain last year as well. Could you talk about some dynamics about how, what is going on here?
Amit, you remember we've discussed this in the past that whenever we value gold, we have variations which happen. We have impact on the inventory valuation whenever gold prices go up or come down, particularly when they come down.
Sure.
This quarter, for example, the second half of the quarter, gold prices have been falling quite steadily. And that has impacted the value. So since we value gold on a FIFO basis, the gold which is lying is more valued at the year-end rate rather than, or closer to the year-end rate rather than the earlier rates.
Sure.
That does have a that has an impact on the valuation. Now, if you realize, we do hedge our gold as well. We hedge it 100%. So it is not that we will actually incur a loss because we are hedged. But what happens is the accounting for standards are different. We cannot recognize the hedged amount when we close our books on inventory valuation.
Sure.
So, therefore, this mismatch has been happening in the past, and we have reported whenever this is material. We don't normally report it on a quarter-on-quarter basis if it's not material. And materiality here, if you ask me, is anything over 10 crores or 15 crores, then we'll talk about it. This
sure.
quarter, it was sizable, very, very sizable. And this 37 crores should come back as a gain in the next quarter, most probably.
Essentially, Amit, you know, the total gross value of the hedge positions and the gross value of the inventory, that difference will flow back when the positions get squared.
Sure. I get it. Totally. That's what I just wanted to confirm, that last quarter in Q4, I think there was a 18 crore gain was there in the base.
Yeah, but because you had a loss the previous quarter. So that's
correct. So if I were to ignore both the gains.
The business,
yeah.
And whenever it is material, we bring it to your
attention.
Perfect. So I think if I ignore this sort of gain, then probably you are not unhappy with jewelry margin, I would assume then.
Yeah.
We are not at all unhappy.
Perfect.
Yeah, happy actually.
Actually, you know, jewelry growth of 20% seems to be also slightly above what you said in the release. It seems to suggest that it's slightly higher than that. So was the March very good, or the February took off, or how did it all work? And, you know, basically, if you talk about how the Q1 so far, whatever has been happening, given the wedding days are also stronger, and do you see the demand uptake, Nakshatra Tritiya and things like that, how the demand picture is looking to you for the Q1 early days, although?
We had a pretty good Akshay Tritiya yesterday and leading up to it over the last 1 week. And our YTD growth is about 19%.
Sure.
So we're pretty happy with it. And our feeling is that the presence of elections in the last 3-4 weeks has certainly had some impact on demand. And we're seeing some recovery in markets where elections have ended. And therefore, we are, you know, expecting a similar turnaround happening in the rest of the markets, which are still yet to go to elections. And June is a very good month in terms of wedding dates. So quarter one as a whole, we expect it to be pretty good.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Venkat. All the best. And, I'll come back in queue.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nilesha from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
Thank you. So can you just explain about this ex-gratia to employees? Was it an account of some BRS, and what is the split between jewelry and the other divisions?
No, this is a company-wide payment we make, and there is a, you see, the company's growth in profit between last year and this year has been substantial, and it's been substantial year on year, and this is one way of aligning the whole company to achieve and set stretch targets and achieve them so that the overall growth drive in the companies across the company. So in a way, it is celebratory. It is not contractual, and it is a gratuitous payment. So based on the significant increase in profit, even after providing for the ILFS and Favril Yuba, we found, the board felt that there is a substantial increase, and it would be shared. It is based on sharing philosophy of the company with its employees.
Sure.
So 2 months of basic pay across the entire company.
Okay, got it. And any split between the broad split between the divisions? In line,
well, it's based on number of employees in each division, so I don't know. I can't, as of straight away, tell you the proportion. Maybe Raj knows the proportion. Raj, are you there?
I'm here, Bhaskar.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, jewelry and watches, of course, are the largest division. So, number of employees.
Mr. Raj, you need to be a little more louder. You're sounding a bit distant.
Yeah. Okay. Jewelry and watches are the largest divisions, of course, from a employee numbers perspective. Eyewear is number three, and then you have numbers in corporate office and also in the new businesses like Tanera and Skin, etc. So the largest are in jewelry and watches.
Yeah, the biggest impact actually would be in the watch business.
Watches, because employment in the factories, etc. is large. Yeah,
that's right.
Okay, got that. And just to the tax bit, I'm unable to reconcile how do you get to this tax rate of 28% for the full year. There's obviously an impact on account of these one-offs that have happened. So could you just give me the tax rate for fourth quarter and try and work it backwards then?
No, I'll just give you, forget the tax rate for the fourth quarter. I'll just basically tell you the big things that happened in this quarter. One was that as far as the ILFS provision is concerned, we have taken a deferred tax asset based on opinions and case laws, which clearly allow us to do that, and which had not been taken by us in the previous quarter. Okay, this was based on opinion, therefore we went ahead and did that. So that is one exception there. The other one was the Favril Yuba impairment, for which we cannot take a DTA because it's a capital loss at this point in time. So it, in a way, compensates each other, but it's not very easy doing a math on this. But by and large, as I mentioned, about 28-29% would be the tax rate for next year as well.
Okay, got that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Harit Kapoor from Investec. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to get firstly your comment on the overall market context. I know you've spoken about how you have done, but if you could just give a sense of, you know, the overall market context and the competitive environment right now on jewelry. This is for jewelry.
It's our sense that during the quarter four, also the industry performance was not particularly good. And while we, you know, ended up growing in the 20% range, but FY20 seems to be a better beginning for the industry, and particularly the last 1 week to, you know, 10 days. So in quarter four, we believe we continue to increase our share like in the earlier quarters.
Understood. Second question was just housekeeping on the tax rate part. So are we saying that the entire tax impact for the entire INFS impairment for the full year has come in Q4?
That is right.
Okay, cool. That's it from me. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Avi Mehta from India Infoline. Please go ahead.
Thank you.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Avi.
Yeah, sir. You just highlighted right now that FY20 has seen a good beginning. Can you give us a sense on how it has been in the till date FY20 performance?
Yeah, in the 37 days of the year so far, we have grown 19% in total retail sales. And we expect to continue this certainly in the first quarter. June is expected, is a very good wedding month. Many, many wedding dates compared to last year, quarter one and June particularly. And we also are hoping post-elections, as elections, you know, happen in every, in each market, the pickup starts in those markets. So it's been a good beginning, just under 20% YTD.
Oh, perfect, sir. This is very heartening to hear. Just, sir, you know, just trying to confirm, there's no divergence between the retail sales and the primary sales in terms of channel, you know, behavior. Would that be a fair understanding or no? Quarter three. Sir,
reporting, from a reporting perspective.
From a reporting perspective, what we see in the sales, there is a divergence.
What Venkat normally talks about is the retail sale. He doesn't talk about the primary. He's not talking about
the primary. Follows retail.
Yeah, yeah.
Because 30% of our sale is, you know, buy and sell. 70% is retail, I mean, through sales, right? The other 30%, there may be a week, a month here, there kind of thing, but it finally catches up.
Okay. And so second was on the wedding dates. If you could give us a sense on how, you know, the increase in wedding dates, does that also help in the year, or how does that behave?
Yeah, the number of wedding dates, you know, over the last so many years, we have seen a very high correlation between the performance of the brands and even the other categories, wherever wedding has a role, correlation between sales and the number of wedding dates.
So the number does have a positive...
If I remember right, FY20 has got at least 40% more wedding dates than FY19.
Okay, perfect. That's all from my end. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prasad Deshmukh from Bank of America. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening to all of you. Just two quick questions. What is the targeted the new store additions in jewelry for next year? Typically, you give it at the end of Q4.
Prasad, actually, day after tomorrow, we are in Mumbai and we'll be sharing this at that time.
Okay. Secondly, on 100% hallmarking regulation, what is the update on this as yet?
Nothing really, Prasad.
So because there have been, there have been media reports in between that discussions that happened at the ministerial level, and they had involved industry bodies and so on.
It's become law. And our last conversation with the concerned department, has not indicated any firm date of becoming law. Also.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Harit Kapoor from Investec. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Just one follow-up was, you know, the industry across, you know, we've heard about liquidity pressures in the channel. So just wanted to, you know, get a sense from you about, you know, whether you are seeing this kind of, any kind of a pushback, you know, from franchises, etc., in terms of, you know, any liquidity constraints from their end.
Well, I mean, there will be more detailed answer from the rest, but I can say from our franchisee's perspective, we've not seen any pushback, nor from watches that are distributors. Yes, there is some level of stress, but not that visible. In jewelry, I don't think there's any problem with the L3s as well. I think my, Venkat, I don't think so, no?
No, not at all. We just had a conference a couple of weeks back.
Correct.
Almost 200 of them and nothing like that at all, Bharat.
Good to know, sir. That's it from me. Thank you.
Thank you.
But those of them who are doing business with other companies, especially auto companies and consumer durables, etc., they do feel demand, you know, there's the demand pressure. I mean, significantly the auto company dealers, who are also Tanishq or Titan watch, you know, franchisees.
Yeah, so it is directly linked to the offtake in the industry, I guess.
Right.
Very clear, sir, very clear. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Preetam Roy from Stewart & Magatich. Please go ahead.
Very good evening, sir. I have just two questions. One is that what is the total wedding collection contributions to the revenue? And this is the first question. And second question is the what is the demand trend visible in the started segment? And what is the present FY19 contributions from the started segment?
Which segment, sorry?
Started jewelry segment.
Ah, okay, okay, okay. Started. Okay.
Twenty, in the early twenties percent. What is the second part, please?
Studded.
YTD, what is the
studded?
27.5.
No, 29 or 30. YTD. And it's growing, Venkat. No, that is the point.
Yeah.
See, the contribution is growing.
All the levers of engines of growth that we have, our, you know, the building blocks are such that many of the levers, if not all of the levers, will individually grow more than the required growth rate for the brand so that they sort of propel the brand in the direction of the 2.5x, and that's happening by and large for all the levers.
Okay, sir, and just one thing I want to clarify that last one or two con call that there is a target was that 20% wedding contributions from wedding contributions, but this is still 20% only, right, from the wedding section?
Yes, it is still 20%. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Any further improvement that we can expect from this segment contribution?
Actually, the growth rate of the wedding segment in FY19 was slightly higher than the overall growth rate for the brand. So actually, the share of wedding to total has improved in FY19, but not significantly, as you point out.
Okay.
And we are looking at continuing to grow this each year. What exactly it is, I will speak about day after tomorrow.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. Best of luck for the team.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, we would like to remind participants that you may press star and one to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Amit Sinha from Macquarie Group. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. My question is again on the wedding jewelry and the high-value studded jewelry which you have been talking about. And just now you gave a number where you said it has just grown above the overall jewelry growth. So the question is the plan which you had for significant growth in these two segments, is it coming off because of now higher base in the overall our profile, our portfolio, or is it because of some other reason? Because I remember FY18, the growth was in excess of 30%.
Actually, in the last three quarters of 3Q and 4Q of FY19, the wedding jewelry growth was in excess of 35%. It was first quarter of FY19 that actually we declined, and that pulled the total growth down for the year. So if I look at the last 9 months, it's been exceptionally good. And we are hoping that this year, because of the point that I made about 40% more wedding dates, the overall wedding business itself will grow faster and get a higher share of the total.
Also, one more point, Venkat, which we have achieved is between last year and this, if you take Q1 of last year and Q1 of this year, the relevance of the wedding, you see, wedding jewelry is not some nationally similar. In each location or each community and sub-community, today we are more relevant in those sub-communities than we were in the first quarter of last year. So I think that also will kick in, you know, the relevance of the jewelry that we made for locals, and that is very, very local taste. Unlike non-wedding purchase or diamond jewelry purchase, wedding is very relevant, and our ability to design jewelry and make it available during the season, relevant jewelry, has improved quite significantly over the years, but between last year and this year as well.
Yeah.
Sure, sir. And just a question on your market share. The last year you had given a kind of an ambition of doubling the market share in the next 5 years. So where have we reached in the last 1 year in terms of the market share? And if you can share any number of market share which you have at this point of time in the jewelry
segment. I'll preface the answer with one thing before Venkat gives the number. I think market share gain would have been quite significant. Exact number I wouldn't know. Not only because of our efforts, but also because of the rest of the market actually facing a downward trend for significant part of last year.
So, actually, I have nothing more than what Bhaskar said, because it's virtually impossible to you know, measure share like this in an industry like us. All we keep doing is every quarter we get an on-ground sense of all key jewelry players in maybe 30, 40 cities. And that keeps telling us over the last certainly 12 months that our growth rate was accompanied by a much lower growth rate on with many of them and declines for many others. And therefore, very clearly we were gaining share. And it's our sense, therefore, that at a 20% CAGR, which is our plan, and even at a 5% CAGR for the rest of the industry, we would have doubled share. I mean, that was the calculation for the doubling of the share in any case. And we are certainly well on the way to that target. So maybe 100 bips jump, if I were to just hazard a guess, but it would be impossible to substantiate.
Sure. And what number will you put for the industry? Was it flat or in FY19?
Very difficult to say. If I go by what is happening on the ground, at best flat.
Sure. And lastly, on the capex side, I mean, what would be the overall capex for FY19?
Well, typically between 200 to 250 crores.
No, the year gone by.
Gone by is about 220.
220. Okay. Okay. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Vora from BNP Paribas. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks, sir. How much did Golden Harvest contribute in fiscal 19, and what was the contribution from Gold Exchange?
20 and 40, I think. 20% GHS and 40% Exchange.
Sure. And second is, what are the trends you are seeing in online jewelry buying? Carat Lane, about 40% growth. So it's good but not great considering the low base.
Please repeat.
The trends in online jewelry buying?
Yeah.
Yeah, like Carat Lane growth of about 40%, it's good but it's not great, I mean, considering the low base. What are the trends which you are seeing in jewelry buying, and when do you see Carat Lane breaking even?
The consumers are still preferring to experience or explore, discover jewelry online, but buy them, after touching and feeling. And therefore, the setting up of the Carat Lane stores for a full omni opportunity is, what we are currently executing. But as we are introducing products which are lower priced, particularly in the, less than 7,000-8,000 rupees, the online opportunity is very much there waiting to be capitalized. And we have seen substantial early gains in the last 3-4 months in Carat Lane as well as within the TCL brands. And so therefore, as long as we remain in the precious jewelry business with prices which are in the 15,000 and all the way up to whatever lakhs, the role of it will be an omni-channel, the role will be digital experience and retail purchase rather than purchasing online, at least in the next 2 to 3 years. But the online itself is a very large opportunity, and we are betting big on it for Carat Lane with the right price point, represented catalogs, and ready-to-ship inventory, and the right kind of targeting of the customers.
And we'll break even quite soon. The attempt is to break even in the year.
Sure. And how is the competitive intensity in online? Would you say it's similar to offline, or online Carat Lane will be doing much better and competition is lower?
Yeah, very clearly Carat Lane is head and shoulders above the rest of the competition in online.
And also nobody else has really come into this space other than the ones we already knew when we bought this company.
Sure. Thanks, sir. That's it from my side.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Pulkit Singhal from Motilal Oswal Securities Limited. Please go ahead.
Thank you. This is from the asset management team. So when you say the industry growth is broadly flat for the year, is there a demand side issue or is this a supply side issue?
Which growth?
Industry growth.
I think it is a combination. See, what has happened is that ever since demonetization happened, I think demonetization was like a shock to a lot of people who used to park cash in jewelry. I think somewhere that was a structural, impact on the industry. And we started hearing, reports from many jewelers who depended on those kind of ticket sizes for their business, and particularly in diamond jewelry starting to struggle starting late 17. The other thing is certainly the industry, banks starting to get to worry about financing the jewelry industry, then the GST introducing a lot of complications in the operations, and people not being able to, bill off the books but keep inventory and account and all that. So from multiple sides, both customer and, both the demand and the supply sides have been affected because of these.
So from the, when you talk about the demand part, I get it, but I thought that that aspect would kind of unwind as the year passes by, as you go into the following years.
I'm just saying it's very difficult to keep a, very close track on it, jeweler by jeweler and all that. I'm just telling you that on the demand side also, and somewhere, I guess, the overall, scene on high-ticket consumption, if I take the autos, for example, somewhere, and jewelry is a high-ticket product. So even though it's a store of value, it's a high-ticket product. So somewhere, the overall discretionary spending level itself is a little low, and I'm sure it has got an impact on jewelry as well.
So just to understand the supply side issue better, does it actually happen that, the customer does not buy jewelry just because a certain kind of jewelry is just not available near his vicinity, and therefore he's deferring his purchase?
I doubt very much.
Right. No,
we haven't seen anything. Yeah.
No, I'm talking about the customers, sort of becoming wary of parking black money in jewelry and all that, which used to happen.
Yeah, that part is
on account of that reason.
So when you get share from your competitors and they have liquidity issues, I'm presuming they're not able to keep the same, even what they were earlier able to keep, and then therefore you can...
It's possible because the bank, like there are many competitors of ours who are sort of... whose overdues to vendors run into 6 months and 9 months and all that, and therefore their ability to replenish their stocks is impeded by that situation. Banks not giving them the kind of credit that they used to give earlier and all that. But the customer migration is also happening because customers are now wanting to shop with, organized brands, and particularly a brand like Tanishq. So in the last 18 months, we have seen substantial migration at high ticket sizes for the first time. Earlier, customers used to come in and buy, new customers would buy a 30,000 and then migrate to 1 lakh on the second, third purchase. But you have people now coming directly and buying a 3 lakh first time. So those are customers who don't anymore want to deal with jewelers of a certain reputation.
So the point, I think, is as follows. Earlier, trust, design and trust were the basis of buying Tanishq. Now, design, trust and safety. They feel safer buying at Tanishq. Even if you're buying less than 2 lakhs worth cash, would rather go to Tanishq, because, the overall environment on cash purchases and all this KYC, etc., has made the customer want to go play safe.
Yeah. Also, particularly in the high-value diamond jewelry space, the incidents that happened relating to the, Mehul Choksi, that time, they created a lot of panic among people about the authenticity of diamonds. And that continues to remain a big advantage for Tanishq.
To that extent, it probably makes a lot of sense to just, rapidly increase the stores very fast before things normalize.
So we are
of course. Yeah.
We will speak day after on that.
Got it. Thank you and all the best.
Yeah,
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vaibhav Goyal from SBI Life Insurance. Please go ahead.
Sir, because 50% of our sales come from exchange, how do we assess the industry growth rate and the way when we say that industry has been stagnant? So how do we come to know the overall pie growth?
No, it is very difficult to come to know, honestly, Vaibhav. All I'm saying is that we have a process of assessing every quarter the performance of, let's say, key jewelers in many of the markets where we operate in. And we, in a way, compare our, growth or decline or whatever with theirs. And that, over the last four quarters, if I were to see, that gives us a sense. And it's very difficult to accumulate all that because, it's not like we know the exact sale of each jeweler in crore terms last year, same quarter, this year. And therefore, add up all that to get a size of the pie. But if you look at, there were so many of them who are negative, some of them small positive, some of them big positive. So, the sense is that together all of them is at best a flat.
Okay, and for us, this pie has grown significantly. So this would have a similar trend on the industry, or it would be only probably related to a few large jewelers.
Question again. It is very difficult to assess. Venkat, the point is, will it have an industry-wide effect in the long run, which means overall industry, will it contract or remain the same? If I understood the question right.
Yes, sir.
Oh, it's very difficult because it's a long-term kind of, you know, question. I don't have a view on it at the moment. Obviously, it would not be in our interest for the industry to continue declining every year for the next many years. It would certainly not be in our interest.
Also, you know, the point we are seeing clearly is, and, you know, we may explain to you the transformation from gold to Tanishq in the small towns. It is very clearly moving towards adornment, okay? And therefore, maybe structurally it is changing in terms of product mix. But the desire to own and buy jewelry still remains very high as far as we can see on the ground. Now, investment jewelry going out and getting replaced by adornment, how that will play out is very difficult to predict.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tejas Shah from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, what will be the variable shares in the overall watches segment for FY19 and what was that number for last year?
Within the watches business, as you know, since we are the number one and do 17 million is the plan this year, but we did 16 million last year, the traditional watches are very big. So therefore, if you look at the share of wearables, as of now, it is sub 10%, but it's going to grow in the future. But I'm very pleased to share that we are now the number two wearables company in India, as confirmed by International Data Corporation. So since we are we are so big in the traditional watches and cover all price segments, all consumer segments across channels, today it is sub 10%, but likely to grow very rapidly.
Great.
Also, I want to add one thing to Ravi's point. I think, you know, we should not jump to the conclusion at all, and it would not be in our interest also as a business, that the wearables will take over the watch business, and therefore people will start wearing wearables instead of wristwatches. Our view has never been that the desire to wear a beautiful piece on your wrist amongst certain number of customers exists and can be enhanced, and we are seeing that with products like Raga and Octane and Nebula and so on and so forth. So that effort will continue. So the wearables effort in a way is additional, and it's going to get more people into the Titan company fold, into the watch business, like you said, personal devices and wearables. Therefore, that first question on, you know, marginal cost or, you know, is it coming at a lower margin should not really bother us, because the balance is not a proportion question. It is growth in volume terms and, of course, sensible growth in profit terms.
Just to add to what you said, Bhaskar, it's about, you know, since we are so large already in terms of number of consumers we reach out to, I think the wearable strategy is helping us acquire new customers.
Exactly.
Specifically youth who are, you know, stopping to wear watches and are, you know, looking at only activity bands. So acquiring new customers is really the reason for that.
So the way you explained on jewelry that the value proposition is design and the whole retail experience, in wearables, the competition landscape is much more different than our traditional watches run. So what is the value proposition that you believe that consumers are seeing in our offerings?
Titan has always approached every category very differently from the rest of the market. And to know more about how we are approaching this, can we wait till day after?
Sure, sir. Thanks and all the best. That's it for me.
Thank you. That was the last question. I now hand the conference over to the management for their closing comments.
Thank you all for your very insightful questions. I hope we'll meet all of you the day after tomorrow in Mumbai. Thank you. All the very best.